We went to a very different event last night. I'll just say this. I have just one question for the panel after this. And that was at a book group in Baldwin Hills at a lovely home, and about two dozen black women, teachers, secretaries, lawyers, producers. I think there were four who were married. And they'd also read the book, and their biggest question, you know, it's fascinating to me to hear these very intellectual questions. Their biggest question was, where do I find these white men that want to marry me, and how do I fall in love with them? So it was. I'll take your name after the session. But it was very different, and this has me thinking of a whole set of other issues that you raised that all hinge around the issue of choices, though. And there was the question about the peer relationships and whether what you have to navigate in a relationship with someone who is another race may be just as difficult as navigating a relationship with your same race but who is not educationally or financially or intellectually your equal. So that's one question. Another question was, I had never thought of it, I love this one. Is swag dysfunctional, or does it serve a certain socio-cultural function? I'll be pondering that one. And what does middle-class masculinity look like? That's another question. And these all speak to the issue kind of, I think somebody said, one of you said about women making better choices, how to make better choices about how and whom to partner with. And I think that's a question that's relevant to all of us. And I guess the question that I want to hear on a kind of an institutional or intellectual level is there was a lot in that room last night, a lot of angst and a lot of sense of failure and despair. And it wasn't necessarily, I want to be married, because a lot of these women had been married or whatever, but they want partners. And I think the desire to partner with somebody is a natural part of who we are. Is there a sense or research or anything, or do you think his book deals at all with is there a corrosive effect on women, black women, and this is very personal to me as one of these, you know, married for a while and then widowed and really struggling to find that kind of, you know, black man like my brother. Is there a corrosive effect on women, black women, who kind of go through years of feeling despair over, and not that their lives aren't good, but they're, you know, it's a good life, but this is it, basically. It's me and my dogs and my lovely house, and that's it. Is that an issue that ought to be taken? Is it a personal issue, or is it a broader collective social issue? And I don't know if anybody else is interested in that, but or you want to answer that, or you know, I mean, I thought you all raised it in some level, but I don't know. Is it, or is it just sad for us, or is it something that we should be worried about doing something about? I guess.
I think culture, right, constructs preferences, and this goes to Melissa's point about the centrality of marriage, that it's hard to, you have a lot of sympathy for someone who wants the long-term partnership.
Right.
But we also have to understand the social context in which those preferences form. And if we can have a more engaged discussion about how those preferences are forming, maybe women could imagine their lives in a different way. Maybe they would then look at the same set of facts,
right,
the same set of relationships they've had over the course of their life, and interpret that in a completely different way.
That's a good answer.
Let me just add this, because this is a big issue. Thank you for raising it. This is a big issue, and I guess through the course of this book, in the course of researching and writing, I became much less normative on the marriage issue. Because, again, when I teach family law, you know, students will complain that the whole course is this critique of marriage, right? Because we're in a law school classroom, that's what we do, right? We're supposed to critique legal institutions. But when I went out to start interviewing people, I found out that the critique of marriage actually has no traction among people out in the world, right? They weren't ready to hear that, you know, you should imagine things differently, this is not what you want, and you should want something different, and you've been conditioned culturally to want these things that are actually not in your best interest. And marriage, in fact, has been a way to control women and a way to control property, and that's all true, but that's not where people were. And their desire, I think it is a desire that is not simply culturally and socially conditioned. It's a transcendent desire. I think that, you know, every society that we know of has had something like marriage, a conjugal unit that raises children and produces the next generation. Every society, I think there's actually one very small one that did not, right? But every society we know of has had that. So I have come to think that that is an expectation or a hope or a desire to have a partner in your life that, you know, it's not the end of life if you don't, but, you know, do people start out thinking, you know, I don't want a partner and I just want to go it alone? No. Would most people be happy if they had some wonderful partner? Yes. So I actually don't critique that desire.
I just wanted to say one minor thing about that is the black women who were at this party, did they have best friends where the relationship was more than 10 or 15 years long? A person who they shared their hopes and joys for their children with? A person who understood their career aspirations? Are they not already partnered at some level but completely disregard those relationships? And then I just take your point about marriage and pleasure. Right, I think the reason that actually my comments didn't focus on, well, you shouldn't want this, you should want something else, is that I think a lot of the unhappiness about marriage is really related to these conflicted feelings women have about masculinity. That is, they enter these partnerships, and then these conflicted feelings they have about masculinity doom them to failure. And until they work through those, I think they can only expect more of the same.
That's a fascinating point. And that's, you will hear that from men a lot. In my column, I wrote a column about this issue, and the overriding thing I heard from men was about women don't know what they want when it comes to masculinity.
I want to come back to Rick's point. It's true, women may want partners, but having a partner doesn't have to mean being married. And it may be that people, they go hand in hand, they're linked, but again, that happens against a set of background endowments where we have been conditioned to understand partnership, to look in a particular way, to have a particular script to it. And again, maybe if we could sort of break out of that and imagine, you know, maybe think about the fact that I have a best friend, I actually am partnered. It's not a romantic partnership, but it's a fulfilling partnership that may fill certain needs, but I may need to fill other needs, and it may not be through a long-term partnership that I fulfill those other needs. And if we can just imagine the way we talk about what life is like outside of marriage, I mean, you sort of see the way culture works. I mean, when women talk about, I'm not looking for Mr. Right, I'm looking for Mr. Right Now, it sounds promiscuous and, you know, unsatisfying, right? I mean, the idea is that Mr. Right is the preferable option. Mr. Right Now is in the meantime, right? And not preferable. But, you know, what if you satisfied the needs that you assume Mr. Right would fulfill with someone else, like Ms. Right, who's, you know, your very good friend who's known you forever and been through everything with you, but Mr. Right Now satisfied other needs. Mm-hmm. And with that, your life was actually complete. What if we divested marriage of so much of the meaning that it has culturally, such that maybe the black men who don't get married because there is so much freighted with marriage, like the performing masculinity in a certain way, becoming a breadwinner in a particular way, are suddenly more, I guess, unfettered in making the institution one that fits where they are right now. And everyone is perhaps happy.
Let me just say that this, to emphasize again, this book, this is a book about in the meantime. I mean, I agree with many of the panelists on the question of, you know, can we imagine alternative cultures, alternative societies? You know, I'm fully open to that, and some of those alternative societies may be different than our society now, and they may have different norms and values and different social formations, and I'm on board with all of that. But again, I think that's cold comfort. You know, if I'm talking to someone, that's actually cold comfort to say, well, you know, we should have had a society that has, you know, these different values, and, you know, you can imagine yourself different, because the reality is that we're all, you know, culturally contingent right now. We're in this society. We're rooted in this society with its norms and values. And just a small point about the economic issue, you know, so I talked in the book a lot about the economic gaps between husbands and wives, right? And the fact that, you know, more than 50% of college-educated black wives have husbands who are less educated than they are, right? So 50% of professional black women, to think of it, are married to blue-collar men, that education difference translates into an income difference. You have lots of black families out there where the wife supports the family because the husband does not, cannot. And one response is to say, well, why should that matter, right? We should, sort of let go of these ideas of masculinity. But in fact, none of us, I will say, no one in this room is fully able to relinquish those ideas of masculinity, because those ideas of masculinity are so deeply rooted in our society, and one of the most persistent gender roles, even as gender roles have evolved, and men can do childcare and women can work, is that the husband is expected to be a breadwinner. And the husband is expected to produce economically, and that's not simply enforced by the couple, it's actually enforced by everyone around them, by their friends, by their families, by everything that's in their social environment. And I just think it's much more deeply rooted than we imagine it is, or want to imagine it is. And the empirical data is that, including one, many studies that are not in the book, but my former colleague, Paula England, who's a sociologist now at NYU, she did a study that found that the wife's employment status doesn't affect the likelihood of divorce. When the women are out of work, divorce risk does not increase. When the man is out of work, the risk of divorce does increase dramatically, right? And there is also research that just shows, in the aggregate, when the woman earns substantially more than the husband, the couple is more likely to split up than when the husband earns more than the woman. And this is not an endorsement of that relationship. This is not an endorsement of that cultural value, but it is a recognition that we're all rooted in this cultural context. And for better or for worse, we have to navigate it. And I think I think it's asking too much of black women in another way to ask black women to shed, or black men, to shed all these cultural norms that the rest of the society participates in as well, and that it would be virtually impossible for them to free themselves of.
Professor Buchanan, and then we will go.
I just wanted to make one quick point, which is that this discussion has hit on a tension that we see in LGBT rights organizing all the time, which is this critique of marriage that's been very powerful against the very sincere desire of people to get married, right? And so we're starting to get some interesting research on constituent perspectives from gay men and lesbians, from some sociologists, particularly at the University of Minnesota, that's showing that the lower income identified lesbians and gay men desire marriage at similar rates to higher income lesbian and gay men, racial minorities at similar rates, and actually in the qualitative data, the marriage critiques that we get are usually from demographically white, upper income, highly educated, and older lesbians and gay men. And so it's the same sort of tension, and it's really hard to navigate that while, and I think the movement's trying to do that right now, while being critical of centering everything around the institution, but recognizing the very sincere desire of constituents to want to be married, to want to partner, and to want to do what they think goes along with partnership, right? And so we've seen the prominent queer critiques of marriage, at least as a matter of popular culture, really recede, partly because of that.
We have microphones that can go around.
Okay.
I just wanted to respond to, I hear what you're saying is that it's not that easy to just let go of the desire to be in a relationship, and I think, and I agree with both of you, that the desire to be in a relationship is probably something that most people feel and need, and that I'm skeptical that a best friend would, when I was single, I don't think that my friends really fulfilled that desire for me. But I also actually agree with Rick that the marriage decline in black communities, especially given the lower rates of marital satisfaction amongst those who are married, is not a good thing. But not, I think, for the same reasons. And I actually agree with this prescription that it's hard enough to find somebody that you love without putting further restrictions on it, given that it's hard to negotiate relationships anyway, without putting further racial restrictions on it. But what I think is missing is a point that, so I'm not saying really think of it differently as much as to understand that the absence of marriage and the unhappiness of many of the marriages that are there are kind of like high rates of high blood pressure in black communities, in the sense that they're both epiphenomena of the, they're kind of psychological consequences of the extreme stress of being black in this society. And that is not
that can't really be remedied by changing your mind about how it is, because the stress is still, racism is still there. But there are structural issues that make it so stressful to be black. There's mm-hmm. pervasive interpersonal racism, then there's getting blocked at every turn professionally and educationally. And there's the, you know, and there are degrading stereotypes, but also real obstacles to achieving the kind of financial security that makes it easier to have a happy relationship by when you don't have to fight about money all the time. But I think that low marriage rate, so I don't really see marrying non-black men or even higher rates of marriage among black people as necessarily solving any of those problems, which goes back to Melissa's, the importance that Melissa pointed to structural solutions. But on the level of marriage, I think it would have been useful, that would be a different book, but to examine, what's going on with those black couples that are happy? Because it seems to me that given their larger numbers, it might be useful to see how they resist all those structural factors to find personal and relationship happiness in spite of the situations that, as Rick says, are unlikely to change in the immediate future. And mm-hmm. it's also more consistent with what his interviewees say they want. Mm-hmm. If they're not attracted to white men, and it's important to them that their partner understand racism, then I'm not sure that white men are suitable spouses for them.
But you know, that goes to the question too, I think, of as somebody said, learn to make how and why we make choices. And what I heard a lot of the women saying last night was, maybe I need to think more, you know, deeply about what specifically I want, rather than, you know, presuming it has to come in this package. And I think that's what, to me, that's kind of what this opened a whole way of discussion about it, what it, you know, this attraction thing and all that. But maybe it's time to think about, if I really know what I want, I'll be more likely to find it.
I just want to add something to something that Kim said. So it's, you're looking at these structural issues in the next project, and structural issues regarding the pressures that members of the black community face, but I think there's an equally compelling critique here about the structural issues regarding marriage. Like, what is marriage structured to perform in our society? You know, my interest in sort of looking for alternatives to marriage is not a blind one. I recognize that there are these very powerful cultural scripts. I recognize that people very much want to be married. But my question for all of us is there a way that you could make marriage matter less, such that the failure to, if you want to call it a failure, to get married doesn't loom so large in the lives of individuals? Like, maybe if we were more like the Scandinavian countries with that robust social safety net, we could think about partnering in a lot of different ways that would make our, like, reduce some of these structural stresses that Kim has identified, but wouldn't stress out the long-term relationships we did have, might bring more people into the pool, but and didn't have to do the kind of work we want marriage to. We want marriage to do a lot of things.
Yeah. And so we're gonna, Melissa, we're gonna bring people in from the audience so they have a chance to enter the conversation as well.